Okay, so thanks for the invitation and for the introduction. And it's nice to be here. I was here as a graduate student, which was a while back. These days, what my lab studies is evolutionary population genetics, as Michael mentioned, which on a very general level means that we are interested in the processes that give rise to genetic and phenotypic differences between individuals, populations, and closely related species, where to that end, we use mathematical models to model these processes, and we use statistics in order to make inferences about these processes from data. In this rather famous picture that was taken in Connecticut, State Agricultural College in 1977, someone had the brilliant idea of having students where the women are in white and the men are in black, and just line them according to their height. I'm showing you this picture just to say that height, like, is just one example of many, many quantitative traits which show considerable variation. Much of it is genetic or heritable in origin among individuals in human populations. And the work I'm going to tell you about today is work we're doing in order to understand the processes that give rise to this kind of a phenotypic variation. When I eventually get to talk about what we did, then the heavy lifting of the work was done by an incredibly talented graduate student called Yuval Simmons, who you see over here. But before I go to the work itself, then actually perhaps most of the talk, I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we know about quantitative traits more generally, just to get everybody to the same page. And in that respect, please feel free to ask me questions. I don't know, I assume that the backgrounds here are pretty diverse, so if I use some term that's unclear and so on, please stop me. So first I'll start by what I mean by a quantitative trait. And you can think about quantitative traits as the opposite extreme from Mendelian traits. And so in a Mendelian trait, mutations in a single gene usually have a fairly predictable outcome. So it could be the shape of a pea seed, whether it's smooth or dented, or whether it's green or yellow, and so on and so forth. Or it could also be one of many human Mendelian diseases like cystic fibrosis or Huntington and so on. In the quantitative extreme, then the value of a trait is actually determined by many, many loci, by variance in many, many loci throughout the genome, plus an environmental effect. And what that means among consequences is that if I tell you the allele at a specific site that affects the trait, it will probably tell you pretty little about the phenotype. Now, a lot of the phenotypes that we care about are actually quantitative. So that includes morphological traits like height or body mass index, or life history traits like the age of puberty, or the risk of developing most common diseases that are complex, that include type 1 and type 2 diabetes, so a bunch of psychiatric disorders, including autism spectrum disorder and schizophrenia and multiple sclerosis and so on. The list goes on. We know a lot about Mendelian traits, and we've known a lot about Mendelian traits for a while. So we know the genetic basis for at least practically all the common Mendelian traits in humans, and the reason is that they are very easy to map in familial studies. We also have a pretty good understanding of why Mendelian traits are as common as they are, and that usually involves some balance between a mutation and selection against that mutation, and usually some combination of demographic processes. In contrast, with regards to quantitative traits, only in the past decade it became possible to systematically map their genetic basis, and that ushered a huge wave of progress, and in fact is on the forefront of human genetics today. So when if you go to a meeting of the American Society of Human Genetics, more than a third of the sessions would be related to this progress. In the all these precision medicine initiatives, national and institutional, that you hear about are related to this progress, et cetera. The modern thinking about quantitative traits goes back to a set of models introduced by Ronald Fisher and Sewell Wright in the 20s and 30s of the 20th century. And I'm going to walk you through a cartoon of this model, again, taking height as an example. You could think of this as a cartoon of a diploid genome, where each circle corresponds to a base pair. And the white circles that are positions or sites that affect height, and the gray ones are those that don't affect height. And then let's assume for simplicity that at each such a site that affects height, we have two alleles, a tall allele and a short allele in the population, where the average effect on height of replacing one short allele by one tall allele in this particular example would be 2 millimeters, okay? And then other sites have other effect sizes. And then per the additive model, what you do when you want to predict the phenotype of an individual, then you just add up the contributions over all its alleles. This, by the way, this very simple scheme is what underlies most breeding schemes or breeding schemes in agriculture that affect practically everything that's organic that you buy in the supermarket dramatically, and also is the premise for a phenotypic prediction in precision medicine. Now, in addition, there's also some environmental effect on the phenotype, and Fisher assumed that that environmental contribution is taken from some normal distribution. So now if you have the genomes of two individuals, you add up the alleles, you add up the environmental contribution, and you get their height, where I was told in the past that for younger people in the audience, before what Michael said, that I should mention that Sean Condry is taller than Woody Allen to understand this slide. This is the additive model, an extremely simple model. Of course, there's a whole bunch of bells and whistles for other effects you could add, but I won't focus on those today. Instead, I'll mention that this very simple model already explains some very basic observations. So the first observation, which traces back to Francis Galton in the end of the 19th century, is that when you look at a whole bunch of quantitative traits in humans or in other organisms, they're approximately normally distributed. And this is easily explained by the additive model, because if we add a lot of small, approximately independent contributions, then you get a phenotype that's normally distributed. But beyond that, it tells us, the additive model tells us more. It tells us about the width of this normal distribution, about the variance. And under the additive model, the variance has a very simple interpretation. It's the sum of the genetic contribution or heritable contribution to variance plus the environmental contribution to variance. And you could break it further and say that the genetic contribution to variance is just the sum of the contributions to variance in the trait of each of the sites, of the variable sites that contributes to this variance. And in fact, the concept of variance was first introduced by Ronald Fisher in his 1918 paper dealing with this problem specifically. So now I'll just give you a simple example. So this figure is based on the 20 sites that have been found to contribute most to variation in height in Europeans. So each of these sites is biallelic. So you have between, so each individual has between 0 and 40 tall alleles at these sites. Now, just to give you a sense of how polygenic height is, and this is true for quite a few traits, then these 20 sites, variable sites that contribute the most to variance in height in Europeans, each site has an effect size on the order of 2 millimeters and contributes less than 1/3 of 1% of the heritable variance in height. Okay, so you, and these are the top sites. So we're talking about tens of thousands, probably more variants that determine an individual's height. So now what this, so what you see on the x-axis is the number of tall alleles, and on the left y-axis, what you see is the proportion of the sample with this many tall alleles, and it's approximately normally distributed as you see. And then the y-axis on the right, what you see is the average height corresponding to all the individuals in the sample with a certain number of tall alleles. And you see that it behaves approximately linearly as you might expect under the additive model. Okay? So, so that's just an illustration of the additive model. I'll just add, I kind of expected being in Santa Fe that people would add, you know, how come an additive model works so well? And because surely there's nonlinear interactions between different mutations or different variants at different sites. And indeed there are. There are studies in yeast, for example, where people knocked out every gene in yeast and then knocked out every pairs of genes in yeast and found that indeed there are what in biology we call epistatic interactions between these variants. But what turns out, and there's a lot of thinking about this in population genetics, that there's a difference between newly arising mutations that also include these loss of function type mutations and the mutations that actually end up segregating at appreciable frequencies in the population and contributing to variants in traits. And those that actually segregate, and a whole bunch of other arguments are actually, there's good reasons to believe that the additive model is a very good approximation for this problem. And actually, there's quite a bit of empirical work that shows that this is indeed the case. So just moving on, another question you may ask is, I mentioned that this model is also the premise for calculating disease risk for complex disease in humans. And how do we use this additive model of a continuous trait to model a discrete trait like a disease, either you're sick or not? And so here's an illustration of the basic models in human genetics take approximately this form, where we assume that there's an additive trait that's a result of many small genetic contributions and an environmental contribution that is usually called a liability. And then the assumption is if you cross a certain threshold, you're sick. And if you're below that, you're not. And there's variations on these models, but they're pretty much equivalent. So, moving on, the additive model also explains an additional important observation, and this is observations also going back to Galton and the first biometricians about the correlation between relatives in quantitative traits. So specifically here, what you see is a famous figure from Francis Galton, where on the x-axis you have the average height of parents, and on the y-axis, the height of the child, where obviously there's the proper normalizations for males and females. And the size of the circles just represents how many points in the sample fall in a certain grid point. And the dashed line is just the y equal x line. And if height was completely genetic determined, then we would expect the regression to fall on this y equal x line. In reality, when we perform the regression, we get the black line that you see there, the solid line that you see there, with a bit of a lower slope. And in fact, again, noting that the history of modern statistics is actually very strongly tied with these questions, then I'm pretty sure that Pearson developed linear regression because of this problem. So what you might expect is that you might expect that this linear relationship, this linear statistical relationship, that the slope would be lower as the trait is less heritable, more determined by the environment and less by genetics. So actually, there is a much more precise interpretation of this, and that is that we could define, and this is how in genetics we give a quantitative answer to the nature versus nurture question, if you like. We define the heritability of a trait as the proportion of phenotypic variance that is genetic. Okay, so as you see over here, this H squared is the heritability, and it's the genetic variance divided by the total phenotypic variance. And it turns out that the slope of this particular regression of children's phenotypes against the average of their parents is exactly this heritability, okay? And
this assumes that the environment is not heritable, that the environment is
right. So So that's a good question. There's a whole bunch of so in fact there are several notions of heritability. What I described here is more precisely called narrow sense heritability, and which is the additive component. And you could add to this a whole bunch of gene by environment interactions and various things about the environment and so on, and nonlinear interactions. But in the simplest definition, this is how heritability is defined. And this gives you a tool to estimate heritabilities. And indeed, heritabilities have been estimated for a whole a bunch of phenotypes in humans and in other organisms. Here are some examples. For humans, specifically in European populations, here you see a bunch of heritability values that were estimated for Europeans. And one thing you may notice from this example, and turns out to be quite generally true, is for the bulk of traits, heritabilities are usually considerable. So they usually fall somewhere between 15 and 90%. So the heritable contribution to almost every phenotype you look is considerable. And we don't know why. Okay, this is an open question. Another, yeah.
But that would be an example where if the environment was inherited, you
get
that result, right?
So not necessarily, because until recently, there's a whole bunch of ways where heritability is estimated, and the golden standard until maybe a decade ago for estimating heritability was based on comparing monozygotic and dizygotic twins, where the model controlled for the shared environment in that way. So of course you could say maybe the level of shared environment for identical versus non-identical twin is different, but there's a whole bunch of methodologies to actually control for shared environment, and these estimates are based, actually I think specifically these are based on twin studies, so that wouldn't be an issue. And today there's also ways of estimating heritabilities actually not based on close relatives, but actually about based on individuals that are very unrelated, just because today we could actually measure how much of their genome they share. And generally speaking, generalizing over a lot of different things, then the estimates are fairly consistent. Yeah, but these are problems that Francis Galton was the first person to actually systematically think about these problems, was already well aware and was looking for all kinds of sophisticated statistical devices in order to deal with problems like that. So is that Michael's question about Shadrach? Yeah, there's a sure. Okay. So if I don't answer, then push further. Okay. So then there's other patterns. Yeah.
So Finland, that's when you look at the Flynn effect and IQ and so forth, it's the same.
What?
When you look at IQ, some of the early interesting results also come from Finland. Is that because this is their military records?
No. May you, okay, are you talking of Finland or Iceland? I think you may be talking about Iceland, and one of the reasons that a lot of recent results in Nature and Science are about Iceland. So there's also, okay, so.
I mean
you mean Finland?
They did IQ tests as part of the military records.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, there's all kinds of, you know, these days there's specific countries and populations where there's better data sets than others. One is Iceland, just because Decode, which is a private company, bought the rights for that, and you know have practically samples from all the Icelandic population plus pedigree data, etc. In Finland, there's they were fairly early to generate like large scale genomic studies, and obviously along with various phenotyping, there's one in Denmark. Now there's the UK Biobank, which is so. And you know, soon, hopefully, in the U.S., they would also get their act together to do this. There's projects in the way, but for some reason, it's kind of like lagging behind. But specifically about IQ, that kind of thing, I rather leave to the end because that raises a whole bunch of issues, and there's a whole bunch of issues with these studies of IQ specifically. I don't know. There's this history of. Kind of like there's these waves in history where these underlying prejudice kind of like keep recurring in cycles of a few decades, and now there's one with genetics, which is kind of like a maybe one after the bell curve one and so on, but that's I'm going to deal with much less charged phenotypes for today. So another pattern just to mention is that you may not see the examples here. It's for a whole bunch of species, but the only point here is that generally you see that, for example, heritabilities tend to be much larger for morphological traits than for life history related traits. Again, we don't know why. There's literature about it, but it's pretty much an open question. So as I mentioned, the huge wave of progress, and there's been a huge wave of progress in being able to actually dissect systematically the genetic basis for these traits. And to a large part, this is due to genome-wide association studies. So let me just run you through what the idea is, which is incredibly simple. What you do is you just genotype a whole bunch of people, a huge sample of people, and you also phenotype them. You measure their height, for example. And then what you do is you regress the trait value against the genotype at every variable site. So here you see an example where at a given variable site, you have like three genotypes, and you have the trait value, and you regress. And then you get the slope. The slope is related to the effect size of the alleles at this particular site. And the slope is also associated with a p-value, of like how strong we could statistically establish the association. And then what you do is, in order to correct for multiple testing and a whole bunch of other issues like population structure and a whole bunch of issues I won't go into, usually you present the data like this. So here you have the minus log p-value, so the more significant is up. And here you have every SNP in the genotyping array, organized by, so these are human chromosomes, the different colors, okay? And then you set some threshold based on statistical considerations, and everything above the threshold in this plot is genome-wide significant, and you established an association, okay? So that's the basic idea. And now when you ask yourself about the power or the P, what determines the p-value of a particular site, then you could think of it as follows. So, obviously, if a site has a greater effect size, it would be, everything else being equal, it would be easier to detect a significant association. But also, you care about the frequency of the minor allele, because if the minor allele is very rare, then you won't have enough instances to get statistical significance. And at the end of the day, the way the two of them combine is exactly the contribution of this site to variance in the trait, okay? And that maps directly to the p-value. And the reason I'm telling you this is because it's going to be important in a minute, but just to give you an example, continuing with height, so the latest genome-wide association study for height was based on something like 250,000 people that were genotyped at more than 2 million variable sites, or SNPs as they're referred to, single nucleotide polymorphisms. In this way I described to you, they found about 700 genome-wide significant associations. But now, you know, we also know the heritability for height, so we also know, you know, what we could do to check how well we're doing is we could add up the contribution to variance of each of these sites, and we could ask how does that compare with what we know from twin studies should be the overall genetic contribution to heritability. And then what you find is that it's about 20 to 25% of the heritable variance in height is explained by these 700 loci. And this problem recurs for many traits and has been termed the missing heritability problem. And if you want to understand the missing heritability problem, I think it's been, you know, misrepresented, I think, in many ways, then a good way to understand the missing heritability problem is to represent the results of a GWAS, these genome-wide significant SNPs, in the following way that I plotted here. So on the x-axis is the minor allele frequency, okay? And on the y-axis, you have the effect size in some units, never mind which. And this representation, if I had all the alleles, all the sites contributing to variation in the trait, that's what people in this field call genetic architecture of the trait, okay, this joint distribution. But specifically, the black line there corresponds to the power of the study, where to a good approximation, things above that line you would detect, and below it you wouldn't. And as you see, it aligns very well with these data, and this suggests that to a large part, and this is also the emerging consensus, is that missing heritability just means that a lot of the variation in the trait comes from from alleles that are either at too low a frequency or have too low an effect size for us to detect with our current sample sizes. Okay. But one thing we could do when we look at the results of GWAS is this way. We could also, so here I just want to mention that each study, depending on its size, has some,
I just want to see if I understood.
Yeah.
In effect, what you're saying is that the consensus now is that in your terms between quantitative and Mendelian, it just turns out that height is more quantitative than we thought.
Right.
That is, there's just many more loci that contribute sort of unmeasurable amounts.
Right.
For the missing heritability.
Yeah. I think that part of the surprise there, you know, beyond the fact that, you know, maybe in order to get funding, people promised that, you know, we're going to resolve the genetic basis for all traits in a few years or something like that. Part of the surprise was that, you know, we're using these huge study sizes, like sample sizes of 250,000, and we still explain only 20% of the heritability in this trait or other. I think that would primarily suggest that people have really bad priors for things they don't have any information about. There's also a famous example the draft of the Human Genome Project was published, there were bets at Cold Spring Harbor, the biology of genomes, of how many genes humans will have. And I think the lowest bet was 50 or 100,000. That was the lowest bet. Of course, it's like, you know, around 20,000. So it's just, you know, when you don't have any information, even smart people, you know, don't guess very well. But that's my personal view about this. Right.
It looks like there are slightly more large effect alleles with a low minor allele frequency than one would expect if effect size were fully uncorrelated with minor allele frequency.
Yeah, I didn't say they're not correlated.
Well,
and, yeah.
Curious.
Yeah.
Is there work on that? Are they? And if so, are there some nice sort of potential models of why?
Yeah, so actually when I get to my work, then, you know, that's one work on it. So if I don't answer you in a few slides, then ask me again, Okay. Yeah.
Sorry, another question. Is there a Bayesian alternative to what effectively looks like frequentist framework here?
Yeah. So actually, you know, I presented it in terms of threshold and significance and so on. But this was all actually the golden standard. The reason people usually note at least last year that it was a decade to modern GWAS the first modern GWAS by many is considered this paper by the Wellcome Trust Case Control Consortium, which was largely led by Peter Donnelly, who's a very serious Bayesian statistician, and he had a box in that paper about how should you determine this threshold p-value, where he suggested that thinking about it in a context of a multiple test correction would be incorrect and suggested some alternatives. So definitely there's, you know, a lot of very strong statisticians have worked about this, and you know, a lot of them are Bayesian or not frequentialists, I don't know if I'm the best person to comment about it, but the answer is yes, definitely. Moving on, to a good approximation, you could approximate the power in a genome-wide association study in terms of a threshold contribution of a site to variance, where if a site contributes above this threshold, you detect it, and below you don't, where the threshold goes down as the study size increases, allowing you to detect more and more sites. And one thing you could do is you could then plot the lines corresponding to smaller study size and say, okay, if I would perform a smaller GWAS, how many sites would I detect? How much variance would I explain? And this way you could plot these lines for different traits where, you know, here on the left you have what percent of their heritability you explain as a function of study size. Where you see examples here for height and body mass index, and you could do the same for the number of sites you detect. And when you look at these plots for a whole variety of GWAS, what you see on a qualitative level is a similar picture, where until a certain study size, you see practically nothing, and then both the explained heritability and number of loci begin to increase rather rapidly. But both this threshold study size and the rate of ascend is actually different for different traits. And based on the picture I showed you, it follows that this is a result of these different traits having different genetic architecture, so different distributions of frequencies and effect sizes. So if you want to understand the missing heritability problem and to predict what's going to happen in the future mapping efforts, because you know, in 2 years or such, we're going to have genome-wide association studies with a million or millions of people and so on, then we want to understand how genetic architectures are formed and why they may differ between traits, okay? And now I can actually tell you what we worked on. Now I could articulate some of the questions that I want to tell you a little bit about. So, one thing I'm going to give you a taste of, hopefully, is that we model the evolutionary processes that give rise to genetic architectures, and that already gives you quite a few insights about how to think about GWAS and so on. But what makes it perhaps more interesting is that then you could go to the other direction, is you could actually test your models and you could make inferences about basic evolutionary parameters based on the findings of genome-wide association studies. And that may allow you, the hope is that may allow you to address a whole bunch of questions. So from the kind of like basic science perspective, one kind of question is, what are the processes? This is a question that goes back 100 years. What are the processes that maintain quantitative genetic variation? Another is, why do they seem to differ between different kinds of traits? So I mentioned morphological and life history traits. You could imagine it differing between early and late onset diseases and so on. And from a practical perspective, you may gain some insight about missing heritability, predict what's going to happen when you increase study sizes, inform future mapping efforts, maybe phenotypic prediction and so on. So these are a whole bunch of goals. And so now I'll tell you a little bit about how we go about modeling this. And I'll start with a cartoon just to give you a very basic intuition about the forces at play here. So here's this, again, the scheme of genetic architecture with effect size on the y-axis and minor allele frequency on the x-axis. And How does architecture begin? So to begin with, mutations that affect a trait arise at some rate, depending on their target size, at how many base pairs in the genome, if you mutate them, would affect the trait. Okay? And now once they arise, the frequencies they reach depends on demographic processes on the one hand and genetic drift, and on the other hand on the selection acting on these mutations, where for reasons, there's a whole bunch of good reasons to assume that for most of these mutations, the selection is actually against them. So selection is pushing them to lower frequencies. So now you might expect the stronger the selection, the frequency is going to be lower. Okay. Now, architecture also depends on the relationship between the selection acting on the mutation and its effect on the trait we're looking at. Okay. Where you could think about two extremes, just to begin thinking about it. One extreme is where the trait we're looking at has actually no effect on fitness, in which case you could think that the selection on the mutation affecting that trait actually results from that mutation's effects on other traits that affect it pleiotropically. In that case, we might think that there would be no relationship between effect size and allele frequency. So I'm relating to what you said before. So maybe the stronger selection pushes in this direction, and if there's no relation, maybe the architecture would look something like that. So, you know, more density near lower frequencies, but otherwise no relationship with effect size. Then you could think about another extreme, where actually it's the trait we're looking at, which is the reason why the mutations are under selection. Okay, and then you could think that if a trait has a larger effect size, it's under stronger selection and therefore would be at lower frequency. So that may give you schematically like a picture like this, okay, in terms of architecture. The only thing I want you to take away from the slide, which is obviously a cartoon, we'll just to get us started, is that a direct and pleiotropic selection are key determinants of architecture. So direct is on the trait we're looking at, and pleiotropic is it through other traits that the variation affects. Okay, so now what do we know about selection acting on quantitative traits? So we know from a whole bunch of evidence that a lot of quantitative traits are under what's called stabilizing selection. So stabilizing selection means that there's some favored intermediate value, and if you move away from it, your fitness goes down. One source of information is that we see that fitness components, namely viability and fecundity, go down as you go away from an intermediate value for a whole bunch of traits in humans, including height. There's studies that show that in species in the wild and in manipulations in the lab. So here's a famous example known for a birth weight where there's a sweet spot for birth weight. When you go above it or below it, then infant mortality increases. But that seems to be, there's a ton of evidence of a whole variety to that effect. So we're going to assume stabilizing selection. But the fact that you know that the trait is under, that trait appears to be under stabilizing selection doesn't mean that the trait itself is being selected on. It could be that the pleiotropic effect of the variation on other traits. So what do we know about pleiotropy? And what a whole bunch of theory and empirical evidence seems to suggest is that pleiotropy is pervasive, okay? So just to note one line of evidence, which is arising indeed from human GWAS, is that when you look at genetic variation, when you analyze genetic variation affecting more than one trait, you find more and more examples of pleiotropy. This is a quote from a beautiful paper by Joe Pickerel from a couple of years back, where a sentence there, he says that variants that delay the age of men or she in women tend to delay age of voice drop in men, decrease body mass index, increase adult height, and decrease risk of male pattern baldness, which Joe refers to as the George Constanza genetic gradient. And but more generally, what the picture that's emerging from GWAS, but there's also a whole bunch of other lines of evidence, is that as our methodology and power to detect it increases, we're just discovering pleiotropy everywhere. So pleiotropy seems to be pervasive. We need to take it into account in modeling. Last thing I'll mention as kind of like empirical guides to modeling architecture is that the results of GWAS seemed to suggest that for a lot of quantitative traits, their result, the quantitative genetic variation, is the result of a small additive contributions from numerous loci. Okay? So that those are some observations to guide the modeling, and now I'll move to tell you about the modeling. Yeah.
I wanted to ask a question that maybe it's not here the right place to ask, but right on many traits you could imagine that it's the bigger the trait is, the better. But then on the other hand, because of pleiotropy, something else causes you to have that you can't be so big because your voice will be too low or something like this. So that is included here, that you have stabilizing selection, but one half is on the trait and one half is on other traits that causes you to then.
So here you're describing a situation where there's directional selection on one trait and stabilizing selection on another.
No, there's two opposing directional selections. Like one causes the trait, maybe in peacocks, the bigger the tail, the better, but then you can't fly or something like this.
Right, but that would suggest that in effect, it's not the bigger the tail, the better. That
right,
actually there's an intermediate.
It's rather effect because the bigger tail then causes some other effect that causes you to not have the big tail.
Right. So there's a. There's but particularly it's interesting to try to come up with examples. But there's some conceptual issue here with how we define a phenotype. A phenotype is actually everything we could measure, where it means that, there's an effectively infinite number of phenotypes, and also means that it probably has no, special biological meaning. I don't know, a lot of traits you look at show this intermediate value with regards to what the explanation is, whether it's selection on the trait you're looking at or not, then there's this term in the evolutionary quantitative genetic literature called apparent selection, where you see something that's, around an intermediate value, but the reason is not selection on that trait itself, but rather on other traits. But that should generally be covered by pleiotropy, I think. Yeah.
I'm wondering if there's a distinction between, I'm thinking of it right now as two kinds of pleiotropy. One of them is due to something like proximity on a chromosome or something. It comes along for, as it were, arbitrary reasons. And the other is where things are linked because of phenotypic interaction between phenotypic effects. So if let's take height and baldness. They're opposed,
I don't remember,
well,
but yeah.
Let's suppose they're opposed.
I think they work in the same direction, but that's just based on it being called the George Constanza.
If they're opposed, they're sort of cartoon fashion. Two possible explanations. One of them is that somehow being tall changes your physiology in such a way as to make hair loss less likely.
Right.
And the other is, no, there's nothing like that. It's just that the genes, the loci in question, happen to, when you get selection for greater height, you also get selection
right
because of proximity.
Right. Yeah. So I think probably both are going on.
Yeah.
This again is kind of like orthogonal to my work, but actually there's been some very interesting work about this. So Jonathan Pritchard and people from his lab had this very interesting paper last year. It's a perspective in cell called From Polygenic to Omnigenic, where what they look at, for example, if you take height, but this recurs for many phenotypes, and you try to ask, and many people try to do that, could we predict, for example, the parts of the genome, now I'm relating to the first kind of pleiotropy, the parts of the genome that are more likely to appear as affecting a given trait, okay? And And people tried a whole bunch of variable things, you know, beginning from, you know, these various essay annotations of the genome and so on. And you know, are they pathways that we think may be related to the trait we're looking at and so on and so forth. What turns out to be the case, and this is kind of surprising, is that when you want to predict where you're going to get genotype hits or where you're going to get substantial p-values, then the only thing that really seems to do for many traits that seems to do anything for you is that if there's some tissues that which are obviously related to the trait, then open chromatin, the parts of the genome that are open chromatin on there, are indeed, you know, more likely to appear as associated with that trait. Okay, but then when you try to look more specifically at specific pathways that you think are related, or things that within the open chromatin are seem to you more active or whatever, then you manage your predictive ability in the statistical sense is diddly squat. Okay, now. One possible interpretation, so, you know, Jonathan suggests an interpretation, I'll suggest my version, so he's not responsible for that, is that, for example, you could think about that if you're a, you know, a cell within a tissue that affects trait, you know, one picture, which was the picture when that was advocated when starting these projects in order to find drug targets for diseases and stuff like that, was, you know, by doing association studies, we're going to detect, you know, the pathways that are key for a given disease, okay? And then we could develop drug targets and so on. Turns out that this is not what the data for GWAS are showing us, it appears. What it seems to be showing us, that everything that affects the expression of any gene in a given tissue, for example, may affect the expression of any other gene in that tissue. Now, we're talking about, remember, we're talking about small effects because they're segregating in the population. If you had like some huge effect, it probably wouldn't segregate. So perhaps what we have, the picture that's emerging in terms of molecular biology, is of these weak interactions that, you know, because the things that determine gene expression in a given tissue, a lot of the mechanisms are shared. So, right, there's transcription and translation and degradation and ribosomes and so on, that you can imagine these weak interactions. So perhaps that's what we're seeing right now. So, now, returning to your question, so this relates to the first type of pleiotropy. So, you know, with some very, you know, constraints from the outset about tissues that are relevant, then it seems that everything affects everything, at least in a weak way. So that's one kind of thing. Then, of course, there's also effects of, you know, linkage disequilibrium, like you were talking about, that things are, you know, we know that there's approximately, in some sense, a certain number of blocks that move together in human variation. And that would be another type of constraint. But even on the level of the, you know, of the individual mutation, it seems that the first type of pleiotropy is pervasive. So yeah, that's a partial answer too.
But I think wouldn't it be because you have so many sites that affect the character, in order for that to generate correlation, there somehow needs to be a correlation between those sites that, you know, like that make you higher and those sites that cause you to be bolder. And you also need a correlation between, you know, like the big, because most of the effects are very small, and those wouldn't generate any correlation. So I think that just because it's so many sites, it can't be linked.
Yeah, I don't think. Yeah, I don't know. You know, I think linkage plays a role, but it seems that there's like on a very fundamental level. Another way of looking at this is that, but I'll get to it. You know, maybe I'll stop in a second just because otherwise I won't get to tell you anything about what you did. Is that you know, what also appears to be the case is that the target size, the number of base pairs that affect phenotypes in the genome is huge. You know, there's almost like a pigeonhole type principle where, you know, there's just too many phenotypes, each of them affected by a huge number of parts of the genome, so they have to be, you know, the same. That's, you know, another way to view it. But anyway, I'm going to skip to models of architecture for the moment, but I'm glad to return to it. I find this very interesting, so I have no... So, okay, so stabilizing selection, pervasive pleiotropy, small effect size for many loci. So here's how we model it. We kind of like, in some sense, this is a framework laid down for by Fisher for a different type of question. But we're thinking about we're modeling a phenotype in a multidimensional trait space. So you know, the first dimension may be height, the second may be body mass index, and so on. So these people would be tall and bulky, and so on. Now we're going to model the architecture of one trait, but the total number of traits will parameterize the degree of pleiotropy in the model. Okay. Now, to model stabilizing selection in this multidimensional trait space, what we do is we assume that some phenotype is preferred, for example, the one in the origin, and that fitness goes down as you move away from it. The way we're going to model mutations is we're going to assume that the mutation is a vector in this space, okay, in this n-dimensional trait space. It comes from some distribution of its size and its direction. Turns out that the specific distribution is not going to matter much. Also, the specific form of the fitness function around the peak doesn't matter much. Also, we could ignore the environmental contribution because we could absorb it into the shape of the peak. But anyway, a mutation is a vector in this n-dimensional trait space. And then to get an individual's phenotype, we just use a multidimensional version of this additive model I showed you. We just add the vector contributions of its alleles in order to get its phenotype in the n-dimensional trait space. And in terms of the population dynamics, we make the standard assumptions that are made in population genetics. So we assume that there's some finite population size of diploid genomes. In each generation, individuals are selected to breed according to their fitness, which is determined, as I told you. And then there's a mutation or combination, Mendelian segregation, you know, the standard assumptions. Now, two things to note about this model. One is that it's generative, so we're starting from the basic processes here. So rather than assuming relationships between the variables we care about. The other is that it turns out that the solution to this model, and we could solve this model, that's always nice when that happens, is robust to a lot of variations on the basic assumptions, some of which I already mentioned. So there's hope that it actually would hold quite generally. Now, I'm going to skip how we solve it in the interest of time, but I'm glad to return to that during questions, and I'll skip directly to the results about GWAS, what this tells us about GWAS. And about genetic architecture. And the way I'm going to relate it to genetic architecture is based on what I told you. So if you recall, the power, so for a given GWAS of a given size, it would detect loci above a certain threshold contribution to genetic variance in the trait and won't detect those that are below. So on the x-axis, I'll have the threshold contribution to variance. And on the y-axis, I'll have the proportion of the heritable variance that comes from loci with that contribution or more, okay? Just because I'm thinking about relating it to GWAS. And so here I could show you the distribution that I'm showing you here is actually a distribution that corresponds to the case where that is sufficiently pleiotropic, that is highly pleiotropic, that we have a large number of traits. And to strongly selected mutations, okay, which has a precise definition in population genetics, but it's above a certain strength. Now, what turns out to be the case is that so long as pleiotropy is sufficiently high and so long as selection is sufficiently strong, then the shape of this distribution actually does not depend on the specific degree of pleiotropy or on how strong selection is. So you get the same distribution. Now, what about weakly selected mutations? So it turns out that they contribute much less. So if we think about GWAS, then if we think about what we would discover, so we start with small study sizes, and as we increase the study size, the threshold goes down. Then we're going to capture the strongly selected stuff. And only after we capture a lot of the variance that comes from strongly selected stuff are we going to begin to discover the more weakly selected stuff. So it stands to reason, it's plausible that what we're seeing right now is actually the strongly selected variants. Okay, and what's nice about this model is that if we assume that so what's nice about this is the distribution of variants here, that is something that actually the tail of this is exactly what I draw you for different GWAS. So this is what we're discovering in the GWAS at the moment, but we could also ask how much we would discover if there was a smaller sample size. Okay, so we get this whole curve to fit with this distribution. And the distribution that we get depends on only two parameters, the degree of pleiotropy, where when it's sufficiently high, which seems to be plausible for many traits, then it actually converges to a limit form. And the other parameter is actually the expected contribution to variance of a strongly selected site. I didn't mention this is how the x-axis is scaled here. And this other parameter, you could think about it as just choosing natural units to measure variance. So I have two parameters, the degree of pleiotropy, which you know may actually not matter if it's sufficiently high. And the second is the average contribution of strongly selected variants to the genetic variance in the trait. Now, so we have two parameters, and we have, you know, maybe 700 hits for height and about 80 for body mass index, so we could actually fit the distribution still, should have ample power to ask whether our predictions fit the data. So that's what we do. So we specifically, I'll show you the results for height and body mass index. And here I'm showing you what we get. So what you see here, so the graphs here are the same kind of graph. So here is the threshold contribution. Here is what percent of variance comes from loci that contribute this much or more. The red line is just the empirical curve that comes from the GWAS. The black line is the fitted curve for the actually here I'm showing you the fit for the case for this limit form for high pleiotropy. So I only have a single parameter that I'm fitting. And the sleeves are bootstrap-based confidence intervals. And we could actually test, and same thing here for body mass index, and we could actually test whether we could reject our model based on the data. And we do that by, you know, slightly adjusting the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, and we cannot reject the model. Just by comparison, this is a case where, for biologists at least, I usually add that not rejecting the model here is a good thing, not a bad thing. But if we example assume the case without pleiotropy, we could easily reject it. Okay, so we're getting good fits, which is always surprising and exciting. And now the question is, okay, what can we learn about parameters about these traits from the fits that we got? So here are a few things we could begin to learn. One thing we could learn, perhaps not surprisingly, is that genetic variation for these traits is highly pleiotropic, because we could add the degree of pleiotropy as a parameter and we cannot distinguish it from the high pleiotropy limit. Another thing, when we consider the demographic history of European populations where these large GWAS were done, then actually we could show that current GWAS are sensitive to discovering variants that are under a moderate selection, which means that the selection on them is around a tenth of a percent. Okay, I didn't get into it, but this is when you account for demography. Now, we could then ask how much of the genetic variance for height falls within that range, and we could estimate that that's about 40% falls in this range of selection effects. For body mass index, it's less than half than that. And that's to a large part why we think that similarly sized GWAS for height were much more successful in mapping variance than the study for body mass index. Now, another thing we could estimate is for a variance with selection effects within this range, what is their target size? How many base pairs in the genome, if you mutate them, they would affect these traits and be under this range of selection effects. So for height, we estimate that's around 5 million base pairs, and for a body mass index, it's it's less than half of that. So here are, you know, a few examples. I'm going to finish soon. I know I'm beyond the time. So a couple of more slides. So one thing we could do now is we could use our parameter estimates in order to predict what's going to happen in future GWAS, which means that in principle we could also be wrong. Then somebody seemed to care about that. Here's our, you know, first stab at these predictions. So, you know, the red line is what we're getting now for GWAS, and the black line is our extrapolations. These are probably underestimates because as you increase the study size, the range of selection effects you're going to see is going to increase. So we're predicting based on the range we see now. So I'll stop here, so as not to go too much over the time. I'll just say that, you know, I hoped I managed to convince you that using models that start from first principles, we may be able to say something about the results coming out of GWAS, and in the process learn about the processes that maintain quantitative genetic variation, and also maybe inform practical questions like study design and so on. If you're interested in more details, then the manuscript about this is actually on the archive. I'll just end by thanking Yuval Siemens again. So these are members of my lab, all of which are incredibly talented and study very interesting questions I won't tell you about now. But Yuval Siemens did the heavy lifting on this work I told you about today. And now discuss whatever you want.